I'm thrilled to have him here to share with you, Joe Swanberg.
Thank you. Hey, what's up, guys? So I'm going to talk about money, which I think is still somehow a taboo subject right now, and in general makes it really much harder to be a filmmaker because nobody's talking to each other about it. But I think it's useful. And also, you know, it's just like I'm probably like a pretty good example of like if I'm standing here, any idiot could be up here. So maybe I'll just like talk to you about the movies I've made, especially from a financial standpoint. And then I want to leave a lot of time for Q&A because I'll just be I'm really curious to hear what questions you have. And then I'll just be hopefully really honest with the answers. I made my first feature in 2005, which was a really kind of different time. And the first screening of it was here at South by Southwest. And then the movie was called Kissing on the Mouth, which I think is out of print now. It's like impossible to find. You know, it showed here at South by Southwest, which was this really huge like moment for me as a filmmaker, and also this really interesting moment for independent film in general, because the Duplass brothers were here with the Puffy Chair that year, and Andrew Bujalski was here with Mutual Appreciation. And I really like left Austin with this feeling that like something was going on and that it might be possible to make really small movies and have people actually see them. And then that movie got rejected from like every other festival for the next 6 months. And I was like, oh man, maybe I was wrong. Or at least like maybe those guys could do it, but I can't. My response to that was just to want to make another movie, because I had had such a good time here. And I felt so strongly that like whatever was going on financially or career-wise, like the thing I wanted most was to be a part of that. Like whatever that feeling was that I had of like sharing my work, watching other people's work, and being like connected to and part of that scene. And so I started making my second movie, LOL, in the midst of just like a ton of festival rejections. And I live in Chicago. I still live in Chicago, but I was living in Chicago at the time. And we just sort of put our heads down and got back to work. And then that first movie, Kissing on the Mouth, sort of kicked around for a little while. And then it got picked up by this DVD distributor called Heretic, which has since gone out of business. You'll notice a recurring theme of my first couple movies, which is that I've worked with a lot of distributors which are now out of business. You know, that movie came out on DVD at a time where DVD was still a thing, which is maybe even like impossible to believe. But, you know, the movie had some sex in it and was like had young people and seemed whatever. And so back then you could get a DVD deal for a movie like that. So this San Francisco company Heretic put it out, and the movie, you know, Netflix was brand new at the time. There was no streaming aspect to Netflix. They just mailed DVDs in the mail. And I remember that Netflix bought 600 copies of it, and Barnes & Noble bought 600 copies of it. And that was enough to already make that movie and DVD profitable. And so the first time I got a check in the mail for a movie I had made. And over the next, 6 months, the movie accumulated a little bit more money, and it had only cost about $3,000 to make anyway. And I was like, all right, man, I'm a working filmmaker, great. And then I made that movie LOL, which also came here to South by Southwest. And while I was here, I met a producer named Anish Savjani who asked me if I wanted to make another movie. And so out of South by Southwest, I sat down with him during the festival and pitched him the idea for a movie that became Hannah Takes the Stairs. And in the meantime, LOL, the movie that I was here with, also got bought for DVD rights by a brand new company. We were going to be the first movie they put out. They were called Benton Films. And they have also since gone out of business. But we got an MG. So I'm going to talk like some business talk. I don't know if you guys know what an MG is, but that's a minimum guarantee. So essentially a distributor is saying, we think the movie is going to do this much business, and so we'll guarantee it to you by writing you a check. It's called an advance also. And what this is a loan. So they're not really paying you. They're just paying you against future profits of your movie. And they're also collecting interest on that. So it's a loan the same way a bank loan would be. So if you have a movie here that you're trying to sell and you're talking about advances and MGs, that's just a loan. And they're going to take that money back. Plus, they're going to take back interest on it. So just know that. But anyway, it's nice to get a loan because typically you are out money. And then it's just a quick way to get that money back. So they gave me an advance of $10,000 for my $5,000 movie, which was just like, at the time for me, the most money I ever could dream of. And then the bottom dropped out on the DVD market. And so that company put a few more DVDs out before going out of business. And LOL, as far as I know, never made a penny. I mean, I certainly never saw anything else. But Hannah Takes the Stairs, coming off of making two movies that were really low budget, Hannah Takes the Stairs we made for about $60,000. And it felt like the most luxurious big budget. I felt like I was making Ben-Hur or something like that. I was like, oh my God, I'd do whatever I want with $60,000. So what I did was get a bunch of actors together and rent an apartment in Chicago. And we all just kind of lived together for a month and made that movie. And that movie also came and premiered at South by Southwest, as did my next several features. In the meantime, I was definitely being rejected by Sundance and a lot of other festivals that I was submitting to. But, you know, South by Southwest kind of continued to be this champion of my work and this nice home for my stuff. And Hannah Takes the Stairs was sort of the first thing that I made where I feel like people really saw it and took note of it. One of the things that I'll just like continually reinforce to you guys is that like the myth of the like brilliant first feature that just like takes off and starts your career is one way to go about it. But then the other way to go about it is just like be so tenacious and make so much shit that like eventually people just like lose their resistance or will to fight against you. And just like start accepting that you're gonna be around and that they should watch your movies. And so, I mean, honestly, I made this movie called Drinking Buddies, which was my 15th feature, which really most people think is the only movie I ever made. But I'll get to that. But anyway, so with my third feature, we got bought by IFC Films, which was really just like insane to me because they were a real distributor. Nothing against Heretic and Benton, these like rest in peace DVD labels, but you know, IFC Films like had put out movies I had seen before. They seemed real to me, and they gave us an advance of $10,000, which is left us still $50,000 in the hole. But we thought people were going to see our movie and they were going to do a theatrical release for it, which was like a big deal. And I mean, honestly, these days, it's still a big deal if any distributor is going to put your movie in movie theaters. So we took that deal, and as the bottom was dropping out on the DVD market, VOD suddenly existed for the first time, which now, like, streaming and VOD seems so commonplace. But at the time, IFC really had to, like, sell this concept that you would watch an independent film on, like, what I consider growing up pay-per-view. Which to me just like existed in hotels. That was like what's, you know, Hollywood movies like 7 months after they came out in movie theaters, you could buy them pay-per-view. But you know, IFC like really had this idea and vision that you could put indie films up on people's like Time Warner or Comcast platform and that people would watch movies from home, new movies. And at the time they were only releasing five titles at a time. And so this movie, Hannah Takes the Stairs, for a lot of just like early adopters and people who were curious about it, was only one of five choices they had of movies to watch on VOD. So we did pretty well. We did a lot of business. I think a lot of people hated that movie. But they were like, oh, it's of the five options I have, this one sounds all right. And so it started a relationship with IFC Films that I then continued for my next like long string of movies. I think they put out seven movies of mine in a row. And what I started doing, because I was financing these movies with credit cards, with like any money I could scrounge together. And, you know, I didn't have, at some point when I made Hannah Takes the Stairs, I'd had a day job when I made my first two movies. At some point when I made Hannah Takes the Stairs, the sort of realities of traveling on the festival circuit with a feature film became such that I had to make a choice. Do I keep the day job and sort of half engage with this process of traveling to festivals and being a filmmaker, or do I quit the day job and fully engage with that process and just choose to be broke or worse? And I was just like, fuck it, man. I want to be a filmmaker. I just got to do that thing. And so starting with Hannah Takes the Stairs, I just didn't have another job other than filmmaker, but the job of filmmaker wasn't paying me anything. And I had to like figure out how to keep making money. And one of the ways to do that was just to sell a movie as quickly as possible. And so after the good relationship with IFC and the release of Hannah Takes the Stairs, I made this other movie called Nights and Weekends. And what I did was before it showed anywhere, I just took it to IFC and I was like, do you guys want to buy it? And they watched it and they said, yeah. And so we had done that movie for about $15,000, I think. We sold it for maybe $25,000. And then my share of those profits were, I don't know, $2,000 or $3,000. But I was like, all right, this will buy me another couple months to make another movie or figure out what else I'm going to do. And so then I made another movie. I made this movie, Alexander the Last, and I did the same thing. I took it to IFC and sold it to them the moment it was finished. And so I got in this kind of rhythm where the work that I was making was always just kind of being financed by the sale of the movie right before it. And so with Alexander the Last, the idea of VOD had sort of sunk in at the time. Like, I remember with Hannah Takes the Stairs, when IFC was first like initiating this VOD idea, they were even buying like TV commercials. I remember my dad calling me from a hotel in San Francisco saying he had seen a trailer of Hannah Takes the Stairs on TV. I mean, this was the tiniest movie ever with no famous actors in it. But, you know, IFC really just had to market the idea of VOD. And so all the movies that were sort of part of IFC's first VOD release got this huge extra boost simply because they were selling a concept in addition to those five specific movies. And then there was also this festival that the IFC Center put together. By the way, like IFC is part of Rainbow Media Networks. I think that it's even like changed since then. Maybe they're part of AMC Networks now. But, you know, it's a brand. So these like different entities of this brand are not necessarily talking to each other. So the IFC Center and IFC Films and the IFC TV channel are just really being run by a bunch of different people, but they're all just branded with IFC. So, but the IFC Center in New York City, which is the movie theater, put together this festival. These movies are called mumblecore now, but at the time everybody hated that word, and so they were trying to not call it that. I think they called it the New Talkies or something. I mean, it's just as bad as mumblecore. At least people remember mumblecore. But anyway, they put on this festival of really low budget American independent films. So if you can't already tell, I happened to start being a filmmaker at a time where there was just a lot of shit going on that I just like caught the wave of. That's like not, I didn't do anything smarter or better. I just really honestly was in the right place at the right time for a lot of this stuff. But it mattered and it made a big difference. And this festival in New York City, as obnoxious as it is, like when shit happens in New York City, people actually pay attention to it. When it happens in a lot of other places, nobody cares. And the truth is, not that many people saw those movies, but the New York Times wrote a big Sunday New York Times article which the other thing I've learned along the way, you know, there's like no press is bad press or no publicity is bad publicity, whatever that saying is. I mean, honestly, the truth is nobody reads anything. So I have been told by people, like, congratulations on the great review of a review that is awful, that is just like calling my movie the worst piece of shit ever. And I was like, oh, nobody even reads the review. They just saw that the review was there. And that sort of became true of these mumblecore movies. So the IFC Center put on this festival. The New York Times wrote this Sunday New York Times article about mumblecore. And then suddenly it was like legitimized in this way where, like, in fact, its actual audience was really tiny. But the perception of it being real allowed me to like sneak two more movies in before people realized nobody was watching those movies. And so Alexander the Last came out. These movies are, by the way, coming out like pretty much a year spaced out from each other, which for me, when I had no money and was just like trying to live off these things, a year is a really long time to make $3,000 or $5,000. I mean, I was just like trying to do a lot of other stuff just to stay alive. But everybody else thought, I mean, that pace was like really fast at the time. I don't know if that's a fast pace anymore. I think that like we've been forced to speed up, but I was especially forced to speed up because I was living off of the movies. I mean, I really was quickly not having any other source of income, but I was doing this web series with my wife called Young American Bodies, where, you know, I think the first season we did 12 episodes. This was, I mean, do you guys even remember web shows? I don't think they exist anymore. There was like a brief period of time where people thought you could make stuff on the internet and make money off of it. And then they quickly realized you couldn't. But I also happened to just like fumble into the time period where they thought you could. And so I pitched this web series to Nerve.com, which is just kind of like a sex and dating site. Does anybody even know what Nerve is? It was like sort of before OkCupid and stuff. You could like meet people to have sex with on Nerve. Early internet, you know? And so I was making this show with my wife, and I think we did the first season, I think we got paid $500 an episode, which again seemed like all the money in the world to me. And then we got a second season where I think I like bravely asked for $1,000 an episode. Probably they were just like so giddy that some kid in Chicago was willing to do it for that cheap, but it seemed like a lot of money to me. And then IFC.com, which again has nothing to do with IFC Films or the IFC Center, independently decided that they liked Young American Bodies and that they would do it jointly with Nerve. And then they had more money. And so season 3 of Young American Bodies, God, I don't know what I did that one for, maybe $2,000. I was like, man, my life is looking good. I keep doubling my budget every season. So I did that. What else was I doing? I was talking at university sometimes, occasionally just like shooting video for, I never did weddings or anything like that, but you know, I mean, I was just trying to piece together a living as best I could and barely doing it, but it was fine. And then season 4 of Young American Bodies, I sort of became acutely aware of the fact that people were watching this show on the internet and that I should ask for more money. But you know, in the meantime, I was just like learning to be a negotiator and learning to stand up for myself and learning to value my own work. And so I went back to them. And also, you know, I mean, this is like a perfect example of how if we all could just talk to each other honestly as filmmakers and share information, we could fuck shit up. I mean, we really could just like storm the gates. But Ty West, who's a really good friend of mine, also pitched a web series to IFC. And they paid him like $5,000 an episode. And I was like, great. Now I know that somebody could get $5,000 an episode. So when I went back to pitch season 4, I was like, I want $5,000 an episode. And they were like, okay. And I was like, oh man, I should have asked for 7. But you know, it's like if I hadn't known Ty and if we hadn't been talking to each other, I probably would have been thrilled with $3,000 an episode. And so, you know, the more we can share information, the more prepared we are to sort of go into these meetings and know who we're doing business with. And so, you know, this web series was kind of like keeping the bills paid a little bit. My wife, Kris, who is also a filmmaker, was teaching high school at the time. It's like the only 2 years in the 16 years we've been together that like either of us had a salary. So a lot of times we were just like broke at different times. It's one of the nice things. I mean, honestly, like if you look at a marriage as like a business partnership, in addition to all the other kinds of partnerships it is, it somehow seemed to work out that like I would be making money when Kris was broke and she would be making money when I was broke. But it's fucking nice to have a partner who can like support you and help you out. And then you've got like two potential income earners to like keep things moving. And so we sort of survived for a couple years like that. And then the web series was just like keeping the momentum going. But in the meantime, this movie, Alexander the Last, that I made was produced by Noah Baumbach. And so it was also the first time that there was like some kind of external industry recognition that I existed. And Noah producing that movie and sort of, I mean, not only did I just learn so much from that guy and grow as a filmmaker a ton, but, you know, his name attached to that project really meant something to people. And the VOD situation had kind of like solidified itself. And the next frontier of that, so, you know, now we have, it's 2009. We have a version of independent film where VOD exists. But the way that that was going was what's called day and date, which is still like a release model that I'm sure a lot of you guys, if you put movies out, I mean, any kind of like small American independent film is probably being released on the day and date model. Like a sort of big theatrical window up front doesn't really exist for like our kinds of small movies. But the next frontier was sort of like, and the thing that I had realized, because, you know, I mean, living off of these movies, I was forced to pay attention to the business aspects of them. And one thing that I had noticed with like Nights and Weekends, for instance, was that when we showed the movie at South by Southwest, it generated a lot of attention. But by the time we tried to put that movie out, 6 months later, 7 months later, nobody cared. I mean, they already had sort of felt like they had read about it and heard about it. And I just could tell that attention spans were shrinking and that the way people were paying attention to small work was changing. And so I was actually down here in Austin and I sat down with Janet. She'd watched the movie and she was like, I want to show it. And she brought up a conversation that she had had with IFC talking about like different ways to work with the festival and different ways to release movies. And I was like, you know, what if we just go ahead and acknowledge that for a really small American independent film with no famous people in it, the period of time when it premieres at a festival is probably the most amount of attention it's ever going to get. What if we just made the movie available then? And IFC had sort of like already been thinking along those lines. And so we sold them Alexander the Last, and we sold it to them enough in advance that when the movie premiered here at South by Southwest, its festival premiere, it was available on VOD that night and stayed available on VOD for the next 3 months. And this was like a really crucial moment for IFC, not only in kind of like putting forward another new sort of VOD model, which meant that they had advertising dollars to again push the model, which meant that my movie got pushed along with the model. But there was like a real desire to establish VOD as legitimate. And so having Noah Baumbach as a producer on that movie was one thing that IFC felt was like taking a big step forward in terms of legitimizing a VOD release, because that guy's a super good filmmaker and an Oscar nominee and stuff. Like, he wouldn't be involved with some low budget piece of crap, right? And so, you know, Noah's brand was just gonna like legitimize my brand and IFC's brand. So everybody was excited about that. I don't know how Noah felt about that, but you know, he was just like supportive and along for that. And then we were gonna try this like festival day and date release with that movie. And I remember the sort of like big key crucial moment in that whole exercise was, could we get critics to review the movie out of its festival premiere? Because, you know, the New York Times and a lot of these places where, as an indie filmmaker, you just have to get them to review your movie if it's going to exist for people. The big question was, would the New York Times, which only reviews movies that are playing for a week theatrically in New York City, treat this as real and review the movie? And so, you know, publicists were hired simply to like push this idea and this new model. And we came here to South by Southwest, and the New York Times agreed to review the movie as if it were being released without a theatrical component, though there was a small follow-up theatrical component. And it was another, not only another step in like my own career, kind of like piggybacking off of this new technology and kind of like existing in the midst of a lot of change going on, but also a sort of like another step forward in like legitimizing the VOD window, which, you know, I mean, looking back on it now, it's legitimized. You know, it's like nobody looks at a VOD release and thinks anything of it other than that's a smart way to put movies out. But, you know, really at the time, it was not looking so hot necessarily. And, you know, as the dream of theatrical has slowly died for all of us, you know, there were still in 2009 a lot of filmmakers who were just like, I don't want to be on VOD. That's admitting defeat. That's like second best. That means nobody liked my movie and it couldn't get a real release. And so we were sort of like inching our way towards making this seem valid. But also, you know, in the meantime, I'm still living off of these movies. And what's nice about that release window, in addition to capitalizing on the amount of attention we were going to get out of South by Southwest, it also meant that the movie was making all of its money right away in the first 3 months, which meant I didn't have to wait 18 months or longer to see my $3,000. I mean, I think by this point I don't think I made more than $3,000 on Alexander the Last. Probably not. Probably not ever still. Not many people saw that movie, I don't think. So we put that out, and then the world, of course, is like keeps changing even more. But one of the things that was happening to me was that I really was getting to a point where I could not live off of $3,000 every 9 months. And so my solution to that was just to make more movies. And so I entered this period of productivity in which I made 7 features in 1 year. And I know that it sounds crazy, but honestly, it wasn't that crazy. Because I met this filmmaker named Adam Wingard. And do you guys know Adam's stuff? He makes horror movies. He made that movie You're Next. Yeah, I mean, clap for him. He's fucking genius. So I met Adam at a film festival in Birmingham, Alabama. And he's the weirdest guy ever. And he came up to me and he was like, hey, man, my movie's playing in the festival. You should come see it. And it was a movie called Popsicle. And I did go see it. And it's so weird. But it's really good and really specific. And then, you know, like maybe 2 years later, I was back in Birmingham and he came up to me again. And I was like, oh, yeah, you're that guy. What's up? And he's like, I don't know. I'm just living in Birmingham and making movies. You know, you should hire me if you ever need a cinematographer. And I was like, who do you think you are, man? Who are you? And he told like just the most insane stories that night and was just like the weirdest, most memorable dude ever. And I flew back home to Chicago, and a few days later, I got a message from him, and he was like, I want you to come down to Birmingham and act in this movie that I'm making about date rape. And I was like, oh my God. That was like literally the last thing in the world I want to do. But I was like, what is this project? And he was like, well, it's going to be an anthology. There's going to be 4 short segments. I've already shot 2 of them. I'll send them to you. I was like, fine, send them to me and I'll look at it. And I was like, there's no way I'm doing this movie. And then I got the DVD in the mail and they were so good. I mean, honestly, within 30 seconds of starting to watch it, I was already writing him back. And I was like, I will do whatever you want, man. This thing is amazing. And so I went down to Birmingham. I was like, how long do I need to come to Birmingham? And he was like, 1 day. And I was like, you're going to shoot a quarter of a movie in one day? And he's like, yeah, I shot the other two in one day. I was like, you shot those in one day? And he was like, yeah. And I was like, all right, I'm going to come down because you're going to teach me how to do that. And so I flew down to Birmingham and he shot it in one day. I thought it turned out really good. And I just watched that guy work for that day and took notes. And I was like, oh my God, you could make a feature in 4 days. You could make a good feature in 4 days. I need to like step it up, man. What am I doing taking a month to make these movies? And, you know, in the meantime, I also had read Roger Corman's book. I don't know if you guys are that into Roger Corman's movies, but, you know, that guy made like 50 feature films in 12 years or something like that before he became a producer. He mostly produces now. Maybe he still directs, but he's a really prolific filmmaker and a really interesting businessman. And I had read in his book that he had made, he made Little Shop of Horrors, not the like, is it 80s, the comedy version that came out? He did ones with Jack Nicholson in the late 50s, I believe. But he had claimed that he had shot Little Shop of Horrors in 2 days. And so there was like this like interesting filmmaker challenge component to it where I had watched Adam do it and I was like, I want to do it. And so I brought Adam up to Chicago and we made this movie called Autoerotic and I just ripped off his model. Autoerotic was four short stories and we shot them in, we probably did the movie in 6 days. I just like was not as fast or good as Adam, but I did my best. We moved quick. We did that movie for $15,000 and sold that one to IFC for $75,000. And that was the first time where I ever actually made some money off of selling a movie. So keep in mind, I'm like seven movies into my career right now, and I just finally made money for the first time. It's worth noting. I mean, it can be really hard and depressing and a long, long road towards feeling like you exist in the industry or feeling like you're making any money. But hang in there. It can happen. Like, it really can. And like I said, it would be seven more movies before I made Drinking Buddies, which most people come up to me and they're like, cool, man, I liked your first movie. Have you made anything else? And I was like, I was working for 10 years before I made that movie. Those movies got released. How do you not know they exist? But nobody knows they exist. So Autoerotic existed in this pocket where I made also, man, what did I make that year? I made this movie called Uncle Kent, which also IFC put out and was the first time Sundance programmed one of my movies, which is like movie number six. And I made a movie called Silver Bullets, Art History, Caitlin Plays Herself, Marriage Material, and The Zone. That's more than seven, but I'm cheating a little bit because I think I made those movies in a kind of like 14-month window. But the thing that I was realizing was I wasn't ever going to make much money off of any of these movies, so I just had to make a lot of movies because one of them was not going to support me, but maybe seven of them could support me. And also because I was so high on this idea that you could make work that fast, because I make these improvised movies and a lot of the spirit of these movies is attempting to capture moments in people's lives and this kind of like specificity that I felt was really enriched by this speedy process. You know, it's like a month is a long time to keep somebody in their head, you know, and to sort of like keep a performer self-conscious and committed to a role. A lot of things happen in a month. People's lives change. People get interested in other projects. If we could condense this window down to like 4 or 5 or 6 days, we really could just like live the movie in a way that I was finding was getting like really interesting performances out of the actors. And for me as a filmmaker, was really keeping me on my toes and keeping me like really sharp and focused. And I was editing as we were shooting these things. And so you know, typically the way those like 5 and 6 day movies went, all the like seven features I made that year were all done in less than a week, I think. The way those were going is we would shoot like 5 or 6 hours a day and then I would go edit for the rest of the night because I was kind of reacting off of what we had shot. And so I needed to see what was there to know whether I had to reshoot some stuff the next day, to know whether the story was making sense. And so they were kind of being written live along with the shooting. Well, none of those movies made any money and did not get any kind of distribution. And again, the world was changing. And so I had sort of like gotten into this system where I was making these movies and selling them to IFC and kind of living off of them. And then finally IFC was like, listen, we're not really putting out small movies like that anymore. And I was like, oh shit, that was sort of my plan. Like, I was just gonna work for you guys for the rest of my life. And they sort of like restructured, they moved into putting out bigger movies. And so I was left with all this stuff that, you know, movies that I really loved, but that were really small and were just like not really gonna come out. So I started putting some of that stuff on the internet. I did a DVD package with Factory 25 of a bunch of those movies where I kind of put them together and released them in a box set. And you know, just kind of like took stock of the fact that I was going to have to figure something else out if I wanted to keep making movies. That thing that I had been doing for like 7 years at that point just was over. And so I got an agent, which was something that I had been really resisting doing for a long time. When Hannah Takes the Stairs came out, I got calls and emails from a bunch of different agents. And I was like, yo, guys, I got it, man. I'm just like in Chicago making movies with my friends. I don't need an agent for that. No, thank you. And then only one guy of that sort of initial bunch kept emailing me and calling me, this guy, David Koppel, who's my agent now. Every like 6 months or a year, he would write me or call me and just be like, how's it going? Have you changed your mind about having an agent? Are you interested in this? And I was always like, nice to hear from you, David. No, I'm still not interested. Well, around 2011, I had a kid. Oh, that year that I made those seven movies also, my wife was pregnant, and which probably has some fucked up complicated thing to do with why I was making so many movies. But I don't know what it means yet. So I would tell you guys if I knew. I'm sure it factors in there somehow. But I had a kid now, and IFC was not going to buy any more of my little movies. And so I was in LA, and three of those movies, Silver Bullets, Art History, and The Zone, sort of like existed together as a bit of a trilogy. And the AFI Festival in LA was showing all three of them together. So it was a really good time where there was like a, you know, LA Times write up and you know, despite the like bleak career prospects at the moment, I looked kind of good because it looked like I had these three movies out that people were paying attention to. In fact, they were not. But anyway, I sat down for breakfast with David Koppel and I was like, LA Times, nice trilogy looking thing, right? And he was like, what do you want to do? And I was like, David, I just need to make money, man. Like, I already have figured out how to make my own personal projects. I don't need help doing that. Get me jobs. I don't care what they are. I literally just need, my wife and I had bought a house too, which was just like really financially irresponsible. But, you know, you sort of like reach these moments in your life where you're like, all right, I got to do it now if I'm ever going to do it. And I wanted to do it. And so from the sale of Uncle Kent, I think, it was like the only time I ever had $20,000 sitting in a bank account. And I was like, if that's not a down payment on a house, we're never going to buy a house. And so we took that money and bought a house with it and then very quickly ran out of money. And so this dude, Alex Orr, who's here. Are you here, Alex? Hey, what's up, man? Right around this time, Alex, who I'd met on the festival circuit in 2007, said that the tax incentives in Georgia were like really great, but if you could hit this certain threshold of spending a certain amount of money, then you could get this money back. And essentially, like, his company was a little bit shy of the threshold. So if we could spend that amount of money to hit the threshold, the money would eventually come back in the tax rebate and the movie would be for free, basically. And it sounded great to me. Not only was I into like the whole grift of like stealing money from the state of Georgia on the tax incentive thing, but also it was another chance to go make a quick movie. And so I went down to Atlanta for how long did we shoot that movie? 10 days or something like that? Yeah. Really quick again. And also, I had a kid at this point, so I didn't want to be away from home for all that long. So we just did it really fast and cheap. And that was the last movie of mine that IFC bought. That was sort of the very tail end of that window. That movie's called 24 Exposure. And actually, Adam Wingard stars in that movie. and was still like really like had in the meantime from being this like weirdo in Birmingham, Alabama, who I was kind of afraid of, had become my cinematographer basically. And then he made Your Next, which was the other kind of like momentous shift in how I was looking at going about making movies. So, you know, Adam Wingard was and still is the poorest filmmaker, just in terms of money, that I ever have known in my life. I mean, I think that guy lived off of $6 a month down in Birmingham. And then, you know, like after a few years of knowing and working with him, I acted in that movie, Your Next. I found myself on the set of Your Next, which, you know, I think was like a $750,000 movie. And that amount of money seemed insane to me, that like one of my friends could get that kind of money to make a movie. And the biggest thing that I learned from Adam was I just watched him work his ass off. I mean, that dude, I've never seen him so focused and so on his game. And it was just so inspiring to be on set with him as a guy who had, like, you know, lived on my couch in Chicago for 3 months and just was like never had any money, to suddenly be making this real movie, this movie that felt like a real movie. And so I came away from that, and I sort of like came away from the idea that the IFC thing was over. And I had this conversation with David Koppel, and I said, just help me make money. And David said, well, I think you could do your movies, but on a slightly bigger scale, and we could go about that. And I was like, I don't want to do that, David. Just help me make money, man. Like, I already know how to make my movies. I don't want to make movies for more than $50,000. Like, that's about as much as I'll ever need. Just, like, get me a job directing TV or something, man. Help me make some money. And he was really adamant about wanting to, like, support and champion my career. And so he's at CAA, which is the agency that I'm at, which is, like, a big behemoth agency. It's, like, the, like, scary real agency. And he was like, well, who are there actors you want to work with? Like, how can I help? If you were here at CAA and you had our resources, what would you do? And I was like really getting into homebrewing at the time and beer. And I had the idea that it would be fun to make a movie within the like Chicago beer scene. And so over the course of several months, just started meeting with actors, and CAA kind of like by default became their finance department set about attempting to raise money to make this movie, which became Drinking Buddies. And so, you know, we put that together from like the spring to the summer of 2012. But the thing about Drinking Buddies, or trying to make Drinking Buddies, is that I don't write scripts for my movies. And if I'm like putting a movie on a credit card, who cares? I'm just like paying for it myself. But trying to raise $650,000 for a movie with no script is impossible. People looked at us like we were fucking crazy. And they were like, well, Joe's made 14 movies. Like, you gotta trust that he knows what he's doing. And people were like, I don't trust that. I'm not gonna give that guy $500,000. And so I had to like figure out how to do something. That I needed to make some money, and Drinking Buddies was looking bleak, like it just wasn't going to happen. And so my producer Alicia Van Coovering was just like talking to literally every person in the world who maybe had some money to finance an indie film, and they all were saying no. And Jake Johnson, who was going to be in that movie, was on that TV show New Girl. And he had to go back to New Girl by August 1st. And so we had this window from, you know, July 7th to August 1st where we had to shoot Drinking Buddies or we weren't going to do it. And I kept, you know, like in the meantime, the thing that I was most afraid of was like, I can't throw all my eggs in this basket, because if we end up not getting the money, I'm fucked, man. I have to like pay my mortgage. Like, I got to make some money. I can't just like sit around hoping Drinking Buddies happens. So I like started to develop this other movie, and met this group of Chicago financiers. This guy, Peter Gilbert, who produced and shot Hoop Dreams, which was one of my all-time favorite movies, and a neighbor of his, this guy, Eddie Linker. And I was like, all right, guys, I may or may not make this movie called Drinking Buddies this summer. If I don't, I want to make something else. Could we scrounge together between you guys and your neighbors, you know, $100,000 or something like that to do this like backup plan movie? And they were like, yeah. And so I called Alicia and I was like, all right, I don't think, I mean, it's not looking good for Drinking Buddies happening. I think I'm just going to go do this other movie because I have to make some money. And she was like, please just hang in there, man. I haven't talked to everybody. I still think there's a way to make Drinking Buddies this summer. And I was like, I don't know that I can risk it because if we miss this window, I also might not get to make the backup plan movie and then I would have nothing. And she was like, this is how it goes, Joe. Like to work at this level, it's just never going to be easy. What I need you to do is just commit to this. And, you know, she kind of like talked me into it. And I was like, all right, fine. We'll try to make Drinking Buddies. And, you know, I just kept giving these dates that were like my out dates where I was like, all right, if, you know, knowing that we had to start shooting by July 7th, I was like, all right, if we don't have the money by May 1st, we can't do it. And then May 1st would come around and Alicia would be like, give me 2 more weeks. I know I can find the money. And I was like, all right, fine. You have 2 more weeks. But if the 2 weeks pass, there's no way we're doing it. I'm going to go do this other thing. And then the 2 weeks would pass. And of course, there was no money. And finally, one group of financiers, these guys called Burn Later, who are still working and making great movies, stepped forward with half of the money. And once half of the money was there, this is sort of how it works at that like slightly bigger level. Once somebody has said they'll give you money, suddenly everybody else is like, oh yeah, we'll give money too. It's just like nobody wants to be the first person, and which is horrific. And as a filmmaker, you just want to like strangle people. You're like, now you want to give us money? Well, what about 3 weeks ago? And they were like, I don't know. Felt scarier back then. Now these other guys trust you, so maybe we'll trust you. And so at the last drop-dead moment, we got the financing for Drinking Buddies, and I went and made that movie, which was just like entirely career-changing and life-changing. And what was most interesting about it is I didn't do anything different than what I had been doing on all of the other movies. It's just that there was famous people in it. And this is like a weird thing about humanity or like the way our brains work or whatever. But when you see famous people doing something, it looks realer and better to you. And you just like it and trust it more. And there's like a gatekeeper quality to famous people, especially like what's crazy about Drinking Buddies is like looking back on it now, you would be like, who the fuck wouldn't want to finance a movie with Olivia Wilde, Anna Kendrick, Jake Johnson, and Ron Livingston? That seems like the most no-brainer movie of all time. But it really was hard to get made. And the lack of a script made it that much harder to get made. But when we finally did it and the movie came out, it was really interesting to observe the changed response to my work and like who I was. And suddenly it felt like 15 features in, people were like, oh yeah, that guy's a filmmaker. And I was like, finally, I've been trying a long time, man. And then this like really interesting thing happened where then everybody wanted to give me money because I'd made a movie that seemed real that made money. And but what I chose to do instead was take that Plan B movie that I'd been developing in case Drinking Buddies didn't happen and just go make that next. And my agent and everybody is like, what are you doing? Because they were like, you just made this $500,000 movie with these great actors that's going to come out next year and everybody's going to like it. Don't make another movie right now. Wait until that one comes out, you idiot. We can get you some money and like whatever you want once people see Drinking Buddies. And I was like, yeah, but I like to work and I already have these Chicago guys who want to give me money to make another movie. I just want to do that. And against everybody's advice, we shot Drinking Buddies in July. And then in December, I was back at it with a movie that became Happy Christmas. And, you know, it's like really interesting. All right, so Anna Kendrick is just the fucking best actor ever. She's so good. And working with her on Drinking Buddies, I was just blown away. And I was like, I just want to work with her the rest of my life. She's so good. And so I just texted her when we finished Drinking Buddies. And I was like, do you want to come back to Chicago and try this again? And, you know, it's like really interesting because Anna's super famous now. And even at the time had already been nominated for an Oscar. It's not like people didn't know who she was. But Pitch Perfect hadn't come out. And her like life and career seems to me like it was really different at that time. And she's awesome and always down to do cool stuff. And she was like, yeah, sure, I'll come back and make something small. And so in December of that year, while we were still in post on Drinking Buddies and finishing that up, I brought a really small team of people together and we made Happy Christmas. And the thing that I did with Happy Christmas was took some of the money that I made on Drinking Buddies and put it as an investor back into Happy Christmas. Because honestly, you guys, the only way you're ever gonna make any money is if you're investing in your own movies. And what's crazy about that is from the moment I like set foot into film school, the one thing I've heard over and over and over again is don't pay for your own movies. Don't do it. Don't finance your own stuff. Get other people to pay for it and just get paid to make it. Why would you finance your own movie? You could lose that money. Well, the thing is, it's also the only way you could ever make money, because the way a movie deal works is that typically, I'll just give you the typical situation, the people who put up the money own half the movie, and then all the artists who make the movie own the other half of the movie. Well, there's a lot of artists that make a movie. So as a director, even if you're doing everything I'm doing, which is writing, directing, editing, producing, craft services, wardrobe, I mean, every job, you still are sharing that half of the movie with a lot of people. And, you know, you end up with, like on Drinking Buddies, I own like 7.5% of that movie out of 100%, right? I'm never going to make any money off of Drinking Buddies, really. I got to own a much bigger percentage if I'm actually going to like take advantage of the success of one of my movies. And so even though we were still super poor, I talked to Kris about it and I was like, I want to take the money that I made from Drinking Buddies and invest it in this Happy Christmas movie, because I think it's the only way we can ever make any money. And so we did it. And that movie, Happy Christmas, we made for like $120,000 or something like that. We shot on Super 16. We did the whole movie in my house. It was a crew of five people. It was just so teeny tiny. But when I sold that movie, it was like really the first time that the sale of my, like one of my movies was really meaningful to me, because not only did I get my creative side of the ownership of that movie, but I also had put money into the investor side. And what I've been doing since then is essentially any amount of money that I'm making is just being rolled back into the next production. Is it a little bit crazy? Definitely. Is it a form of gambling? Definitely. But I'm a gambler, and also it's honestly the only way you can ever make any money. You're just not, you know, unless you're doing a studio movie where they're going to pay you pretty well up front. Like if you're doing independently financed independent film and have the gambling spirit and can afford to, I would really strongly encourage you guys to own your work. I think it's very important. And I also think that even if a movie doesn't make a lot of money right away, a movie is a product that has a really long shelf life. There's a lot of things that could make a movie interesting to people 10 years after it was made, 20 years after it was made, 50 years after it was made. And so the bigger ownership stake you can have in your own work, the more you can be making income off of that movie for the long run. And I'm here to tell you, those early movies that I made, the ones that put those poor DVD distributors out of business, those movies are making more money now than they did back then when they came out, because things like Drinking Buddies and Happy Christmas have come out in the meantime. And so, you know, there's sort of like a constant refresh rate to your own body of work where, you know, once you've made something and put it out in the world, it just may take people a second to catch up to it. And also things like Netflix come along, which just like Netflix streaming didn't exist when I started making movies. These new like licensing platforms come along where you can sell these movies to these like different kinds of avenues. And that is the new, you know, the way that I spent sort of like 7 or 8 years making movies and selling them to IFC. I'm sort of in this like other phase now where essentially what I'm doing is just trying to get bigger and bigger ownership share in my own work until eventually I can just like fully finance these things myself. But also, you know, I've kept them really small and cheap strategically because not only do I like to work that way, but what I found is that, you know, you should always do a movie for as cheap as you possibly can do it and then get paid on the back end if you can afford to. But my feeling is you always can afford to. You just got to be poor or broke, which sucks, but it's not the worst thing in the world. And it will be really advantageous to you in the long run. I sort of wrote like 3 things before we open this up to questions, like 3 things that I think to be true about money that I just wanted to say to you guys as a filmmaker. The first one is I think that it's actually better to have no money than some money when you're making a film. And the difference, you know, that's subjective what no money is or no budget filmmaking is. But I would define it as, could you look a restaurant owner in the eyes and legitimately say to that person, I don't have any money. Can I shoot in your restaurant for free? Right? If you can legitimately say that, then you have no money. If you're lying about it and you have some money, they're going to be able to tell, and so is everybody else on your movie. And some money I have found to be incredibly dangerous and difficult to navigate, because if you have some money, everybody wants some of that some money. If you have no money, everybody just knows it, and then they're there to work. And then in a best case scenario, which I've had a few of these best case scenarios, you sell a movie, and then you're able to pay people afterwards better than you could have paid them if you had some money. And so as you guys put together projects, I would really encourage you, if you're finding yourself in the zone of having some money, to think about doing it for no money and just telling everybody to work for no money and that you'll pay them later. And if your friends are good enough friends or big enough suckers, then you can talk them into this. But then honestly, you may be able to pay them better later. I have often been able to pay people better later. The second thing, which I kind of like commented on with drinking buddies, the second thing I found to be true about money is the less you need money, the more people want to give it to you. And then in a really sick, perverse kind of way, the more you need it, the less anybody wants to give it to you. It's so fucked up about humanity and the way we think about money. But once things are going well for you, everybody wants to give you money. It's the easiest thing in the world to raise money for a movie. And then when you're struggling, everybody's like, ugh, just like the stink of desperation is like wafting off of you, and nobody wants to get anywhere near you. How fucked up is that? But it's true. And so if you have no money and you do need money and nobody's giving you money, I would say to you that like the only, like the best defense mechanism you would have to that would just be to bluff and pretend you don't need money, which that may work in and of itself, weirdly enough. So just like walk into meetings like you don't need any money. People's response to you will be better. And then the other thing you could do, which was what I did a lot of times, is just don't ever ask anybody for money. Just keep paying for your own stuff. Put it on credit cards. Gamble. Because there's this other kind of momentum that builds. If you do it for long enough and you don't ask people for money, where they just assume you have money, and then they also treat you well and feel more inclined to give you money. And then the final thing I'll say about money is that time is money, and you do have to value your time as being worth money. But also, I would say happiness is money too. And so the thing that I would say to you guys in terms of like taking jobs or in your efforts to make money, you have to factor in your time, but you also have to factor in your happiness. And I think a lot of people forget that. It's often just not worth the money to take a shitty job on something that you hate. And what you do occasionally, what I've seen people do occasionally, is poison the well for themselves, because they'll take some money on some job that they don't like or don't want to do. They'll hate it. I mean, anytime I've found myself in the position of making money off of something that I don't like, I fight with my wife a lot more. I'm like snippy with my kid. Like, I'm just in general agitated and upset. And at the end of the day, I look back and I'm like, it wasn't worth the money. I should have just done nothing rather than do that thing, which I hated. And I think that if you can figure out how to navigate that, where you're only working on stuff you love, it's actually a better way towards the goals of making work that people see and the goals of making money. Because what happens is nobody likes a bad movie. And honestly, I don't know any scenario in which I've seen a filmmaker hate the thing they're making and have that movie turn out any good. And so you may think that you're like taking a paycheck or making some money, but in fact, I think you're making the next person who wants to invest in your work or work with you less likely to do it. Making a bad movie that you don't like scares away potential investors on the next project. It scares away actors on the next project. And it just makes it that much harder for you in the long run. So I would encourage you to just really see if you can navigate a career in which you're just always doing things you love. And I think if you can do that, you will have a really successful career. Thanks for listening to me. And I want to like answer questions. So ask me anything and I'll try and be as honest as I can. Yeah. Oh, I think you got to go to that microphone, man. You can just cut in line.
You can cut.
Go for it. We all know you asked the first question.
Appreciate that. When you kind of had a much more substantial budget on Drinking Buddies, how did that kind of affect your, you know, the nuts and bolts sort of working with the actors? And did it affect kind of, you know, I'm sure the set was much more hustle bustle and bigger and everything. Can you speak to that?
Yeah. It was really kind of annoying to me. I wanted to move a lot faster than we were able to move. So I spent the first week just wrapping my head around that. But, you know, eventually I relaxed into it. It just like always helps to be working with people you trust. And I really trusted my cinematographer. And if we needed time to light stuff or if my sound guys needed time to rig something up, my initial response was to be frustrated. And by like week two, I was like, all right, do what you need to do. You know, the hustle and bustle actually what I discovered was that's really good time to just hang out with the actors. You know, it's something that's easy to forget. But one of the nice things about the early small movies I was doing is that it was really communal feeling and everybody was always talking. And there was just like ideas being constantly generated. And I think what happens on a bigger movie is you shoot a scene and then everybody just kind of like goes back to their trailers or whatever. And nobody's talking to each other. And then they come back out and shoot another scene. I think as a director, it's always been really important for me to just like make sure that in between setups, we're still hanging out, that I'm not letting people just like go off and disappear into their own world, that we're like living in it and generating new material. Yeah. Well, I don't know. Let's go over there and then over there.
She was first.
Okay. Hi. I'm actually from Chicago as well. I saw Digging for Fire at the Music Box, and just was really like the actors in that film and who you've been working with have sort of like natural improvisation, just sort of like built into them. And is that something that like you started working with those people because of their improvisational background, or did your like shooting style sort of adapt to the people you were working with?
It adapts, yeah. On Digging for Fire especially, I did not know a lot of those people. I just knew their work, but I didn't know them personally. And so it was really a big question mark of who would be most into that style or not. You know, I knew Jake, and I knew Rosemary a little bit because she's married to Ron Livingston, who I'd worked with on Drinking Buddies. And, you know, Anna Kendrick and some other people who I'd worked with before in that movie. But a lot of those people were new to me. And we were just, like, really figuring it out. But, you know, my like, approach to improv, like, I saw Mike Birbiglia's movie last night, which is really about improv. I don't think that I do that kind of improv in my movies. I'm sort of, like, using improvisation as a storytelling, like, medium. And really what I'm encouraging people to do via the improv is just not act, right? So it's like, if I give you the lines ahead of time, you're going to figure out a performance, and I don't want you to do that. I want you to be forced to just exist in the moment that we're filming, and I'm casting you because I want you to be you. I like you. I like how you talk. I like the kinds of jokes you make. Do those in my movie. Don't, like, go create a character that's something else. And so in a way, it's like the lack of a script is just this, like, forced presence, ideally. And so it's, like, much more about that. And so a lot, I talk to actors a lot of times who are like, I don't know, I don't improvise. Like, I don't know how to do that. And I'm like, it's not about that. Like, we're sitting here having a conversation. If you can do this with me, you can be in one of my movies. This is all I'm asking you to do.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
First, I want to say thanks for being so honest. It's really refreshing.
Yeah, my pleasure, man. I mean, it's honestly the easiest thing in the world to be. But I'm glad you like it.
Yeah, it's really nice, especially in Austin, because we love it. Can you talk for a second about what, I mean, you said that clearly there's no script, but you've got some sort of material, what your treatment looks like, 30 pages, 100 pages.
Yeah, different every time, honestly. Okay. Like, I've done movies with nothing written. And I've done movies with a full-on 80-something page script, basically. It just depends. I'm writing more now than I used to, but I'm also working with actors whose schedules are more complicated than they used to be. I'm honestly, personally, really desiring to do another movie like Hannah Takes the Stairs, where I'm just, like, living with people for a month. But, you know, it's hard with some of the actors who I've now fallen in love with working with, like Jake Johnson or Anna Kendrick or people like that. It's hard to get those guys for a month. I mean, they're really busy. They also have their own personal lives, and I'm still doing really small movies. And so it's one thing for me to want to have fun with them and, like, live with them for a month and make this, like, tiny movie where we all sleep on couches. But for them, it's like, I don't know, man. I just worked for 9 months on a TV show. I want to go be with my family. And so, you know, it sort of forced me into this rhythm of having to work faster and work more in a, like, sort of structured, scheduled way, which by necessity requires more writing. And so I would say that, like, the consistent thing with all of those outlines is a sense of just, like, talking about, they're often in, like, paragraph form. They're not really in, like, you know, script dialogue form, though I have also written, like, sample dialogue sometimes just to give people an idea of how I think it goes. But it's for me to, like, beat out the action, and increasingly it's for the people I'm working with, like, to schedule, budget, you know, costume design. It really just, like, if the information is only in my head, nobody else can do anything. So the outline just becomes a kind of rudimentary way for me to just, like, take some of it from here and put it here so that other people can do their jobs.
Hey.
I'm
really inspired, and I'm so curious to know what a 4-day feature film shoot looks like. And so how do you start the day? Like, where do you begin? I know you touched on it in a lot of different ways, but how do you prepare for that?
I don't do a lot of preparation. I mean, what it looks like is that actually, like, not that complicated, because once you've set about the goal of shooting a lot of stuff in a day, you just got to move. And so, you know, you're doing one take usually, and you're, if something goes horribly wrong, a second take, or you're like, all right, we're not using that take. And so, you know, you just kind of, like, go for it, and you get really strategic and smart about coverage, how you want to shoot stuff. You start to edit in camera a lot. You know, if you're kind of in the middle of a scene, I'm my own editor, which helps a lot. So if I'm in the middle of shooting a dialogue scene and I'm in a wide shot and it starts to feel boring for me, it's definitely going to be boring for the audience. I'll just like move in and get a different shot. And then when I'm in the editing room, I'll just snip out that middle section and find points where that conversation feels like it has a continuous flow. And it's incredible practice. I mean, I would encourage you to do it even if you never showed the movie to anybody, just because really is the thing that I've done in my career that's been the best like toolkit building exercise in terms of like how to think on your feet and how to move quickly.
Great, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. One more question? All right, last question, man.
Hey, Jay, thanks so much for doing this. So I've just made a first feature, which we shot in 5 days, funnily enough. When you have ownership of something, sort of say under the 100K scale,
yeah.
Do you advocate in terms of holding on to that when looking at distribution? Do you advocate for kind of a more self-distribution model with the current climate?
Yeah, it really depends. I would say, like, you got to look at your options. I mean, if you're talking about selling a movie to a distributor for no minimum guarantee and they're not really going to put it out that much, you might as well hold on to it, because even if your own self-distribution effort doesn't go anywhere, you at least still own the movie, so that when your next movie is a hit, you sell the last one. And to me, that's better than tying a movie up with a distributor. You know, it's like distributors don't want to do deals for less than like 7 years at the lower level of that. And a lot of the deals that I've done are for 25 or 30 years. And you're not getting your movie back, you know? And especially if it's a small distributor, man, that distributor might go out of business, which makes the rights complicated later. And then when somebody does want to buy your movie, you're like, I don't actually know who owns it. It just like went into bankruptcy proceedings and some company in India bought the rights to it. And so, you know, you just got to sort of suss out what's going on there. But I, you know, in terms of like time is money, you got to value your time. It's hard to put a movie out. It's like, you got to ask yourself, do I want to be a distributor? The answer for me has always been no. I do not want to be a distributor. So sometimes it's easier to sell your movie to somebody and let them deal with the headache of putting your movie out. I would just say that, like, in those circumstances, fight for good terms and fight for a short term window so that you're getting your movie back before too long. And also make sure that it's in your contract that if they go out of business, the rights revert back to you and they're not for sale to somebody else. And then you're like pretty well covered there. It's better to have a movie out than sitting around, you know? It's like, you never want to make something that's just like doesn't exist in the world. But yeah, it's like, you know, these days, I mean, honestly, with a lot of my movies, what I would have done if it existed was just put them up on Vimeo, you know, pay-per-view or whatever, and just like see what happens. And what's nice about that is the moment you want to pull it off of there, you can, you know, if the situation were to change, you always could just do whatever you wanted with it.
Thanks so much.
Yeah, thank you, man. All right, I guess that's the time. Thanks, guys.